In Pro Mod, tanks are probably the most important part of any round. Because of this, the strategies involved in a tank fight are, quite frankly, gonna take a while to explain, but I'll try to condense this as much as possible. Oh, and as a disclaimer, these strategies should all be taken with a grain of salt. You'll need to bend and flex them to fit into your plan of action during any game. Alright, now with all that out of the way, let's get started. There's nowhere better to start than with basic tank mechanics. There's two really important mechanics that you have to understand to do well with the tank. That's Rage and Line of Sight, or LOS for short. Rage is essentially a timer that counts down how long you have before the tank will pass to another player on your team. The tank will pass control once to a player on your team, and then will pass to a bot. Each time the tank changes control, it's called a pass. So when you spawn in with a tank, that's pass 1. You run out of rage, and it passes to the second player, that's pass 2. And when the second player runs out of rage, it goes bot, and the bot doesn't have a rage counter. However, rage isn't purely a timer, it's a bit more complicated than that. Keeping sight on even one of the survivors will stop the rage counter from going down. You lose sight on the survivors, and it'll start going down again. That is why Line of Sight, or LOS, is such an important concept. By keeping sight on even one of the survivors, it will essentially hold them in one spot for an incredibly long amount of time. Now on top of that, rage can be refilled. Any damage that the tank does to a survivor, besides hitables for some reason, refills the meter back to 100%. So you can combine LOS with rocks, essentially damage from a distance. This gives your team a chance to do a significant amount of damage with Special Infected while you just chill out up on your perch throwing rocks down like a Greek god. Okay, with the basics out of the way, we can break down each stage of the tank fight a bit further. So when you first spawn in with a tank, you'll notice this. See it? But closer. Still nothing? Well, it's not what's there, it's what isn't there. When you spawn in, you'll have a rage timer for about 20 seconds. I know 20 seconds doesn't sound like a whole lot of time, but during that time, since you don't have to worry about rage, you have a huge window to set up your tank fight. So use this time to get hitables into play and to position yourself well. So after that time window ends, you are on first pass. You should have two goals on first pass when you are a tank. Goal 1, keep rage by keeping line of sight and landing rocks. Goal 2, reduce the amount of chip you are taking. Let's start out with the first goal, keeping rage. Since we went over the mechanics, this should be pretty straightforward. There's a few tricks though. Elevation is your friend for this. If you can use a roof to your advantage, do it. It ensures that if survivors are feeling a bit aggressive, you are in a spot where they can't surround you. If you remember, you only need sight on one of the survivors, so even if you're peeking around a corner and see the top of one of the survivors' heads, that's good enough. On top of that, only being able to see one survivor means that only one survivor can see you, which means only one survivor can shoot you. So you reduce chip. Landing rocks is the other component to keeping rage. It seems pretty simple, but it's not as easy as chucking rocks at the survivors, since a lot of the times they'll shoot rocks out of the air, skeeting them. So how do you land rocks when all of them are getting shot down by the one guy who you really don't like and smells kinda funny, but smacking all your shots out of the air? Screw you, Jimmy, basketball camp isn't for kids who take steroids. Well, the answer is you throw rocks during SI attacks. By holding off SI and then attacking all at the same time, you can distract the survivors long enough to land you a vital rock. However, that's not to say you only have to throw rocks during an SI attack. In fact, throwing rocks constantly can help you maintain sight, because the survivors will be shooting the rocks instead of shooting the tank. It also makes them run out of ammo way quicker, which puts them in a spot they really don't want to be in. Just when the attack does go in, that's when you really have to focus on getting a rock to land. Alright, moving on to reducing chip. We already went over keeping sight on only one survivor, but there's a couple more things you can do as well. You can use waist-high cover to block some of the damage from getting shot at, and still be able to throw rocks over it. You can also curve rocks around corners, which is something we'll go over later. Finally, keep your distance. This is more useful if the survivors have tier 1 weapons, like in Pro Mod, or in the first map of a campaign. Tier 1 weapons have a hell of a lot of damage drop off. By simply moving back a couple of yards, you can significantly reduce the amount of damage you take. So second pass. As a tank, you really don't have to change your strategy all that much, until you're ready to commit on the survivors. However, at this point, the Special Infected have a very important task to do. They need to use the Special Infected that they don't want to have for a tank commit early on, and save the Special Infected that they do want. Hopefully, if they kill their spawns early enough, they will have enough time to get their ideal spawns back up for the tank commit. Obviously, the ideal spawns you want for a tank commit vary a bit based on where the tank fight is taking place, but you never want a spitter. The goal of the SI during a tank fight is to reduce the amount of damage the tank is taking, distract the survivors, and incap the survivors to give the tank a better chance. A spitter is the least effective SI to do any of this. In general, you either want 3 incappers or 2 incappers with a boomer. However, going with 2 incappers and a boomer is a lot of the time considered less ideal, because the horde brought in from a boom might not get to the survivors until after the tank fight is over, so use this setup with a bit of caution. After that's done, we move on to committing. The big stuff, the big cheese, the meats of the meal. I'm making myself hungry.
Really, the only word for it is...
You want to start committing around 35% rage. This gives your team enough time to set up what they need to set up, and still early enough that your tank doesn't have a chance to go bot if anything happens. Sometimes, if your rage timer is very low, like 5-10%, it can go bot for no reason. But when you commit, you don't just want to run at the survivors from out in the open. The less of a run-up you have before getting near the survivors, the better. If you start running at them from out in the open, you risk being half-dead by the time you get in range for a punch. When you're finally close to the survivors, your first goal should be to get an incap. By getting an incap, you immediately cut the amount of damage you're taking by 25%, one less gun to worry about. However, survivors actually run faster than the tank, complicating things a bit. Not by very much though, 220 units per second versus 210 units per second. So it's not an impossible task, but it does mean that chasing a survivor in a straight line does not work. What you want to do instead is look for survivors that you can force into a corner, survivors that are slow, or survivors that have commons hitting them. But what if there are no survivors in a situation like that? Well, that's when we have to use a bit of strategy. Survivors will try and maintain a safe distance from tank, which in and of itself doesn't really help that much. But because of this, we can control where they go. The easiest way to describe this is by imagining the survivors at the end of a pencil. The tip of the pencil is the survivors, and your finger is the tank. That's actually really difficult. I didn't expect it to be this difficult. Why is it this difficult? I think it's probably because I'm trying to do this through the viewfinder, and it's inverting all my movements. Not good! It might be easier if I did a bigger thing besides a pencil. Now, the easiest way to explain this effect is by imagining you're balancing a tube at the end of your hands. The tip of the tube is the survivors. Your hand is the tank. The tube, the length of the tube, is the amount of distance that the survivors are trying to maintain. Gotta stand back a bit for this. But if you notice, if I move my hand off to the left, then the survivors will go right. If I move off to the right, survivors go left. So, while looking like an idiot, yeah, I can do that. By using this strategy, we can steer survivors into danger, like a corner or a pull. I think you'll be surprised at just how precisely you can steer them using this method. However, this effect does obviously weaken at further ranges, although it's surprisingly still somewhat present. It's most pronounced right outside of punching range, but you can still notice people avoid your path, even when they're nowhere near close to the tank. So after you get the first incap, that's when the SI want to go in. One less target to deal with means they are less likely to get cleared, and also have the potential for a tri-cap. However, if the tank is really struggling to get that first incap, you might want to send in the SI support around 50% of the tank's health. But you never want to send in the SI before the tank. I can't stress that enough. Let's talk quickly about using survivors as bait. 90% of the time, the survivors will have control over where the tank fight is going to take place. But if you incap a survivor, eventually they'll need to pick them up. A well-placed incap can help you drag out the survivors into a spot that's more in your favor. The last part of committing is hittables, and it's something that confuses many Left 4 Dead 2 players. Once you know how they work, it becomes a bit more friendly though. All objects in Left 4 Dead 2 have a point in the middle of them that all the rotation goes around, called the origin. When you punch a hittable, the force is applied to this point no matter where on the object you hit it. The direction of the force that is applied is determined by where your crosshair is facing. Finally, where you hit the object will determine its rotation. You may have heard you should crouch when hitting a hittable, which does help. This is because it puts you more in line with the object's origin, making you more accurate. Also, because you're closer to the object's center, it doesn't pitch as much, and push the front of it into the ground. Keeping a hittable close to you can help you get closer to the survivors as well. They can't push you if you have the potential to instantly incap them, and you can use the body of the car to block the bullets. However, the second that you hit that car away from you, they'll be extremely aggressive, so try to keep your hits within a close range. Finally, let's go over curve rocks quickly. The name curve rock is a bit misleading, because the trajectory of the rock isn't changing in midair. It isn't really curving. What is actually happening is you're shifting the point at which the rock is being thrown slightly away from the tank. So let's slow this down a bit. You can notice that there's three distinct stages to a rock throw. You have the pickup, the pullback, and then the release. During the pullback, it's like there's a line you're extending out from your body that the rock will be thrown from, and that line locks down right before release. During the lock, you can change where you want the rock to go, which is how you throw around corners. This might be a bit easier to see from the top. Last tip is that rocks can be thrown at survivors during a commit. This is useful if the survivors are out of range and you can't get a corner on them. But it should be noted that it does slow you down, so if you miss, you're pretty much screwed. Alright, so we're done with the breakdown of each stage, but it wasn't totally accurate. The way we broke down the tank fight is like this. Pre-first pass was the setup, first pass was long distance with rocks, second pass was the SI getting ready for the tank commit, and finally, the commit was, well, the commit. Most tank fights don't follow this strict pattern. If the survivors take the tank at a small area, then the tank can't keep sight. Therefore, they can't keep rage, and the whole tank fight gets shorter. So you end up cutting out the whole rocking section, and end up just doing the SI setup right away, and when you have the spawns you want, you commit. If the tank fight is out in an open area, you might want to forget about committing, and end up just rocking if that's what's working. Sometimes, if you take too much damage on the first pass, committing doesn't make sense. But what you'll find is that the most distinguishing characteristics of the best tank player isn't how strictly they follow these patterns, but instead it's how quickly and efficiently they can swap between them. Let's take a look at an actual tank fight to see this. Now, you have already seen some clips of this fight, but let's break it down step by step. This tank fight in particular has a lot of the strategies I went over, so it's a good example. So right off the bat, I'm working my way in. I know they're gonna try to get back to the safe room, so I'm just getting as close as possible while still keeping enough distance that they can't push back into me. Now you can see one of the survivors is trying to do some damage to me, since they know the hit is down and I can't commit on them. I just move off to the side room to avoid taking too much chip. The spawns just came back up for the SI. Since the spot they're finding the tank is so enclosed, I didn't want a smoker. I'm just gonna use the SI spawns early, so we should have the spawns back up by the time I have to commit. That smoker was actually really nice and got him out into the open for me. I chose to get the incap right away on this, so I could use him for bait. Right after the incap, I got back out, which really helped me not to take too much damage. That zero hesitation between changing strategies is one of the most important parts in tanking. Now I'm gonna work my way back in there to incap him again. I want to keep him as bait since it's been working pretty well. My hit just went back up, but I'm gonna ask them to hold off on hitting. My rage is still pretty good, and as long as they have the hit up, the survivors aren't gonna push me. Okay, now my hit is down and the survivors know it. They're getting tired of being rocked, so they're gonna push me hard. But since I chose a spot where I can retreat, I'm just gonna run back when they push me. I'm trying to throw a couple of curve rocks to keep them backed off a bit. I end up missing, but that usually keeps them more passive. Okay, now my tank is very low in health. If they make it back to the safe room and play the tank normally, I have almost no chance of wiping them. That's why I'm gonna call the hit now. I'll try to keep them out so I can keep on rocking them. The smoker didn't land, but there is a really nice quad boom that did. This is probably the best chance I've got at this point, so I'm gonna commit with it. Now if you remember, the horde takes a while to get in after the boom, which is why they aren't all that great for tank fights. So I'm gonna pick a spot that is close to the survivors, and allows me to get in right away when the horde does come in. They're about to make a very bad mistake here. They get too close to the door. That allows me to commit with the double punch, and half the damage I've taken right off the bat. After incapping all the freed survivors, I'm just gonna plop myself in front of the smoke to make it a bit harder to clear. And we're done. That's it for part 1. Part 2, I'm gonna be going over some more survivor-oriented strats, like guns and where you should fight the tank, that sort of stuff. If you want to stick around for a bit, there's an example tank fight of a more hittable-oriented tank, and one that's more of a rock tank. So that's coming up after this part, but there's no commentary, so if you want to end here, you aren't missing that much. If you want to learn more tank tricks, you can go check out my buddy Fish's video. He goes over lots of rock stuff and haymakers and all sorts of things. And here is a video of a speed build that I did about a month ago, if you're into that sort of thing. And finally, the last frag video that I did. Alright, that's it for me. Those tank fights are coming up right about now.